In England, located within a steep gorge, is Peak Cavern, also known as the Devil's Arse. It's famous for its rich history and the myths that surround it. According to legend, in the 16th century, the cave was a popular meeting spot for local thieves.
In the 1500s, bandits used the Devil's Arse to their advantage. It would have been the devil himself making such a noise as to keep anybody away. The bandits were very clever, and they knew exactly how to play the peasants. They wore fancy, exotic clothing. They were masters of close-up magic and palmistry and fortune-telling, and they had an air of mystery about them.
They led people to believe the devil was inside this mammoth cavern.
Stories that the further you went into the earth, the closer you were to hell, worked perfectly to keep them safe from prying eyes. In the 1500s, this was probably the biggest criminal hub in the northwest of Great Britain.
From the depths of the cavern, the bandits enjoyed the fruits of their ill-gotten gains. They called this area the Gates of Hell.
This is the devil's dining room. There was an annual beggar's banquet here. There would have been roasting sheep and hogs and that type of thing. Plenty of food and drink. Apparently one year when they actually did this, the devil actually did come up from the cellar into the dining room. And in return for the hospitality, granted them eternal life.
By the 18th and 19th centuries, the region was a hotbed for lead mining. And soon, more people began moving in.
You got over 100 people living and working within the entrance to the cave.
Barry Jarvis is an expert on the area.
In the Castleton area, literally any hole in the ground was a lead mine. So consequently, they needed a lot of rope.
Over 200 lead mines had been opened within 50 miles of Peak Cavern. And every mine needed huge amounts of rope for hoisting men in and ore out.
Ropes were made out in the fields, which is great on a summer's day, but when it rains, it starts to rot and it's no good for its intended purpose.
Most of the mines were owned by wealthy landowner and aristocrat, the Duke of Devonshire, and he came up with the perfect solution.
The Duke allowed the rope makers to move into the cavern entrance to live and work free of charge, provided at all times there was a master rope maker and an apprentice on site. It was a family industry and the whole family was involved. They had to build these rope walks. They had to excavate the entrance to the cave, and there's 1, 2, 3, 4 rope walks.
A rope walk is a long flat area where ropes are wound and braided, and the cathedral-like space inside Peak Cavern offered shelter from the elements. Even though the living conditions weren't exactly ideal, the rope makers made the best use of their new home. They built cottages, stables, and even an inn.
This is one of the last remaining cottages. This, unbelievably, is a house that would have been home to 8 people. It's absolutely tiny. They stayed here for 300 years, even in these conditions. Everything they needed to make a living was here within the cave.
By the Victorian times, word of the massive caves spread, and soon they became a tourist attraction for the English elite.
We had the likes of Lord Byron, Daniel Defoe, Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. They'd heard stories of the Devil's Cave, so they would come up the gorge and have a peer in. And of course, the rope makers very soon figured out that they could earn extra income by taking these rich people further into the cavern.
Yet some visitors required a little more room to navigate these narrow spaces, and the locals were willing to make accommodations for special guests. In fact, in 1880, the caverns were renamed to appeal to their most famous visitor yet, Her Majesty Queen Victoria. Henceforth, it was known as Peak Cavern, and the locals went out of their way to make sure she had a comfortable trip.
Queen Victoria was a rather large monarch, So there was no way she could fit through that hole in a little lead mining boat. So the lead miners very generously mined this bit of the passage out for her. And that's how it gets its name, Queen Victoria's Passage.
Queen Victoria's Passage was not the only man-made tunnel in this cavern system. Given the extensive natural resources in the area, miners were often excavating the hard limestone in search of new underground riches. In 1770, after lead mining around Peak Caverns proved to be lucrative, its owners came across an ambitious new opportunity. Allowing miners to access fresh seams of lead, the Speedwell Tunnel was created about a mile away by redirecting underground rivers and extending the passageways that ran below Peak Cavern.
So we're now in Speedwell Cavern, which is an old 18th century lead mine.
John Harrison's grandfather bought Speedwell in the 1930s, and it's been owned by his family ever since.
So the rock that the mine is driven through is limestone, carboniferous limestone, which means it's about 340, 350 million years old. It's incredibly hard, and they were using black gunpowder to blast through it, driving shot holes with crowbars and sledgehammers. It was, nothing was automated.
Blasting a tunnel 500 feet underground was an incredible feat of engineering. Miners were working below the water table, so torrents of water would often flood the tunnel following a blast. Faced with the enormous challenge of how to minimize the high water pressure, the miners came up with an ingenious solution that worked to their advantage. They created a canal way on which boats could transport the heavy loads out of the mine.
We're standing in the bottomless pit chamber. It's a huge vertical chamber. The top of it is right up there, 90 meters or so above our heads. This is entirely natural, formed by the action of water dissolving out the softer minerals. So we have limestone on either side, but in the middle, a vertical vein of fluorspar and originally lead that you can trace right the way around the chamber.
But the path ahead of them was treacherous. A massive 98-foot drop to an underground lake.
So the miners built this platform and originally built it as an aqueduct so the boats could continue their journey straight across unhindered to enable them to continue into the far reaches of the mine.
Yet today, the underground labyrinth serves a much different purpose.
For me, this is where it gets interesting. The mains lighting stops and we do some real caving.
Expert caver Mark McCauley has been navigating the subterranean passages for the last 10 years.
And we're into the wild cave. Originally, this area was a coral reef. And there is a fossil of the coral. These muddy puddles are known as the wallows.
Yeah. This is the tube. This passage was formed when it was completely underwater. So underwater passages tend to be circular. This is the main streamway for Peak Cavern, with more or less vertical walls.
Mark and his fellow cavers are discovering new passages all the time.
In the neighboring Speedwell system, we've uncovered 80 meters of new passage. Fewer people have been through these passages than have walked on the moon. Digging it out by hand and moving the mud away, there's likely to be miles of new passage in there.